Welcome to Maxed Out Man, helping you become the man you were made to be.
Hey guys, it's Kevin Davis from the Maxed Out Man podcast. I am here with Keith Edwards. This is episode number 55. Keith helps leaders and organizations to make transformational change for leadership, learning, and equity. Keith is the author of the book Unmasking Toward the Authentic Masculinity, which is based on more than 15 years of award-winning research. I want to talk about some of that research. Keith illuminates men's masking, unmasking, and becoming to help men develop their own authentic masculinity. That's a cool phrase, authentic masculinity. He also shares strategy to help us all better engage the men in our lives with empathy, reach them with compassion, effectively hold them accountable, and help them to become the men they aspire to be, which is right up my alley.
Yeah.
Because our little tagline is, you know, help men be who they were made to be.
Yep.
On Maxed Out Man. So, hey, you know, that is, I want you to go more depth on who you are and what you do and all that. But I love the balance that you've got in that statement, because I think one of the things I picked up on most is that we, you know, treat men with empathy and reach them with compassion, because I don't think that aspect of the that coin is really pushed that much. So but yeah, that's the bio. You've got a lot going on. It's on your website. Yeah. You do a ton of things. So tell us more about you and who you are and what you got going on.
So I'm a speaker, author, and coach. Work for myself, sort of more broadly, and then we'll talk specifically about the masculinity stuff that I think your audience is focused on. So I do a lot of work in higher ed around learning. I do a lot of work on equity and inclusion. I am a certified coach, so I have over 1,000 hours coaching college presidents and CEOs and independent scholars and activists. And I work for myself for the past almost 9 years, which is a remarkable thing to even say out loud. And I'm a father of 2 daughters, so I think that's a relevant part of this conversation.
I have two myself too. Yep, so yeah.
Yeah. And so this book came out of 15 years of research, starting with my dissertation. And I interviewed 10 college men, and then I've interviewed them every 5 years since.
Okay.
And so we've done the conversation when they're about 20, when they're about 25, 30, 35, and next summer we'll do it when they're about 40. And so I've had the conversation with the same 10 men who are very different in terms of identities and their experiences, and then trying to find, even though they're so different, what's the single story that they all share as men? And it's been really interesting to sort of follow them along. So the research initially started being about college men, but it's become about men and parenthood and jobs and career. And I think a lot of the things that I see you talking about and thinking about and that your audience is really interested in. And you mentioned sort of the balance. And I think it's interesting because that balance is really important to me. And I think it depends on kind of the circles you're in, because I think some folks, when they talk about men, just talk about the harm that men do.
Mm-hmm.
And they do, right? Violence, gun violence, sexual violence, talking over women, not listening, all of these things, right? And that's a part of it. And men are also harmed, right? Higher rates of mental health issues, less likely to seek help for it. That violence that men perpetrate, most often it's men who are the victims of that violence. And so men have harder times in relationships. And despite all the privileges and advantages we get in the world, which we do, we still die younger, have higher rates of heart disease, you know, all of these things. And I see that all rooted in sort of how we're socialized as men in a patriarchal culture, which we know certainly oppresses others, but also harms men ourselves. And that's very clear in the participants' lives. It's hard to see, but once you see it all over the place, all over. So I think to say we want to hold men accountable for when they mess up is important, and reach them with compassion and understanding. And most of the conversations I am a part of around men, it's either or. It's either, oh, look how men are suffering. We really need to be there for them. And we do. Or look at all those horrible things men are doing. We really need to make sure they stop doing that. And we do. But if we don't see the roots underneath both of those things, then I think we're just kind of scratching at the symptoms rather than getting it, curing the disease.
Yeah. Do you feel like that's giving, and I want to talk more. I'm a big Andrew Huberman fan, so I love all the data and the, I kind of nerd out on that, and we can talk about anything on this podcast that you want to. We have a lot of stuff, but do you feel like that kind of dichotomy is creating this? I feel like men have a bit of an identity crisis in general right now, whether good or bad. We kind of, back in the day, so to speak, when I was coming up, it's like, this is kind of how you define manhood and masculinity. And I do like how that definition is shifting and changing, but I feel like we're almost in this identity crisis, especially for young men. Now it's like, what is it okay to even be a man? Is it okay to be masculine? Is okay, this patriarchy and all of those words, talk a little bit about that. Cause I have a 24-year-old and a almost 26-year-old daughter. And the youngest one was here over Christmas, and we kind of got into this discussion, and her view of men and masculinity is so different from mine. And both of us are on a little bit different part of the continuum, and we're trying to come together. But
yeah,
but that age range is very different.
Yeah, well, and my daughters are 11 and 13. So their perspective on gender is probably even different than your daughters.
Oh, yeah.
And so I mean, one of the great things about parenthood is you get to rewatch Star Wars for the first time again, and you get to learn about gender for the first time again through sort of their eyes. So I'll make long story short, and I think the most boring word I'll use in this whole conversation is dissertation. We'll skip over that. But what I learned in the research was that the men all had the same secret, and their secret was, I know what the world expects of me to be a man. They were very clear about that. And I said, well, when did you first learn it? And they would say, I've always known that. They're very clear. And then they would sort of share, drink beer, drive a truck, eat meat, be successful, don't study, all of these things, be good at sports. Very clear. And then eventually, usually in the second interview, they would sort of look around to make sure no one was there, even though it was just the two of us. And they would whisper to me, but that's not me. And I would be like, yeah, yeah. And they'd look around and they'd be like, I fake it. I pretend. I wear this mask. And I was like, okay, tell me about that. And their assumption was, these expectations that society had just came naturally to everybody else. It's easy, you're successful and you've done all these things. But for me, I got to work at it. I have self-doubt. I'm not quite so sure. I'm too big. I'm too thin. I'm too smart. I'm not smart enough, whatever the case may be. And so I'll pretend, and I will lie about hookups I've never had. I will lie about drinking amounts that I don't really drink. I will lie about not buying the book and not going to class when I study, when no one's looking. And so this performance, or their metaphor, is putting on my man face, putting on this mask. And initially it was really about sharing with them that you all had the same secret, because they all thought it was just me. I'm the only one who doesn't feel good enough, and I'm the only one who's developed this strategy. And when I shared, all 10 of you shared the same thing. Essentially, they were shocked, because as I mentioned, the men are very different. So scholarship football player looks across at a transgender gay man, and we're like, we told you the same secret. Fraternity president looks across at sexual violence prevention educator, and we're like, we shared the same, we have the same experience. And then they wouldn't stop talking. Well, how does it, and I do this, and I swear, and I do this, and oh yeah, me too. And I lower my voice. Oh, I do too. And sharing those strategies. So that masking to live up to society's expectations. And as you pointed out, those expectations shift. The expectations of me were different for them, different for your daughter, different than what my daughter's friends who are boys are learning, but they're still external expectations. And I think there's, particularly in this age of outrage culture and social media and polarization around not just politics, but everything, we sort of get a lot of the most extreme versions because that's what gets amplified by people liking or people being mad about it. So you see more of it. And I think we're getting sort of that version, certainly politically, but also in terms of masculinity. You have to be this. No, you have to be this. This is wrong. This is right. And I think that's complicated and it's hard and it's confusing. But what happened eventually was this process of sort of understanding their masking and that mask consciousness, knowing I'm wearing a mask. You just pay more attention to how you do it. And then you can do it with choice and consciousness. Like, oh, I'm in a job interview. I'm not going to share about how difficult my divorce is here. Even though that's authentic, it's not the right time and place. Mm-hmm. I'm at coffee with my best friends and I don't really want to get into it. Well, maybe this is the right time and place. I got to push into that. I'm putting on my mask saying everything's fine. It's not actually. And then this process of unmasking, which was kind of a temporary kind of thing where you could, with a coach, maybe I'll take the mask off and say, I'm scared about this, or I'm really excited about this thing, or a relationship, or a parent, or conversation with your daughter, maybe. Mm-hmm. But then it would snap back into place and other things. And then there's a future process, which is, I think, maybe where many of your audience members are, which I'll describe as becoming, and becoming toward authentic masculinity. We can talk about becoming, which is this process really rooted in some coaching things. And then this process of authentic masculinity, which is sort of a differentiation between traditional masculinity, healthy masculinity, which I like, but I don't think goes far enough to then authentic masculinity. I think mm-hmm. when we're reaching for authentic masculinity, then should I be this or this? And I'm getting messages about this or this just becomes external noise. And you start saying, well, that's fine, but I look good in pink. So I'm going to go with that. I don't drink beer. I love meat. And so you get to sort of, rather than, is this manly or is this not, or is this version of masculinity? It's all external. Mm-hmm. And I think that's what I, you know, the traditional masculinity, as you said, some of it works for you and works for me, but some of it's pretty gross. And then there's a lot of people promoting healthy masculinity, which I think is great. It's about respect and being honorable and using your strength to serve others. And I like that, but it's still externally imposed. Mm-hmm. It's still someone else's mask. It may be a better mask, but it's still a mask. So for me, that's not what I'm working on each day. I'm working on, like, what's authentic masculinity for me? Because being a man is a really important part of who I am. Mm-hmm. But I don't want anyone else. I don't want society or advertising on football games or you to define that for me. I want to mm-hmm. like, what is me? What's real? And my answer to that is going to be different than your answer to that. It would be different than Barack Obama's answer to that, right? Like, and so how do we create that authentic masculinity? And when you figure that out, then you get to live it fully and really embrace it rather than pretend or put on this mask. So I said long story short, and then I didn't do that.
No, I love it. There's a lot in there that we can unpack. And I think it's super interesting that all of those men had this kind of externally imposed, externally defined, self-imposed identity of what it means to be a man. And most of it is completely ridiculous, right? Where it's almost like a caricature of masculinity. And we had this discussion with my daughter too, because she was like, and I know you did a show, you actually did, I saw an article or podcast on your website about the Barbie movie, right? Yeah, where you guys did the, but so she wanted us, my wife and I, to watch the Barbie movie. And it's just not, we watched it, mm-hmm. but it's just not our type of movie. Mm-hmm. You know, it just wasn't for us, but that led to some of the more patriarchal kind of stereotypical bad behaviors. And so we got along this discussion. And a lot of what she was giving me all the negative aspects of masculinity. Mm-hmm. And my wife said, none of those mean those, that's not being a man. That's mm-hmm. none of those things is masculine. You know, mm-hmm. none of that behavior is actually what you define masculinity as. And so we got, it was great discussion and really opened up some different aspects of that discussion. But I live in Montana. I'm a, you know, back in the day, they would have called me a metrosexual, right? You're sure. familiar with that old term. It's probably,
I haven't heard that in a while. Yeah.
It's probably offensive to some people, but because, you know, I mean, I do my hair and take care of my nails and wear decent clothes and all those things. And so that was kind of this definition. I'm not a hunter. You know, they have actually this term hunting widows, you know, in September, October, because everybody's, all the guys are gone.
I grew up in Wisconsin. I know exactly what you're talking about. Yeah.
I mean, I am a car guy, but I don't have any car guy friends. So like, you know, I don't drink. I've been married to my wife for 28 years. Love her to death.
Yep.
It gets better all the time. Like, so I'm kind of the anti, you know, man in a lot of aspects of myself.
But and I think, super tied in other aspects.
Yeah.
Right. To the external expectation, right? There's a lot of ways you really do fit sort of the external expectations, and a lot of ways you don't.
Yeah.
And that's my experience too. Right. So many ways that, but that's what I like, is that I get to choose. I don't get to say, oh, this is what I have to be. And, you know, the flip side of what you have to be is what you can't be, right? You can't pay attention to your hair and your nails, right? That's you can't cry at movies. You can't share emotional vulnerability. You can't share your fear and self-doubt. You do need to hunt. You do need to drink beer. You do need to drive a truck. You do need to know how to fix cars, right? So there's a lot of what we should think, feel, and do, and not think, feel, and do. And as you're pointing out, and we share this experience, but in different ways, is that there are ways that works for you. There, you know, if you could pick and choose some, that's me. Yeah, that's authentic. That's really who I am. And then, oh no, that's not me. That's not me. And I think that's somewhat how I think about it. And I am challenging myself not to look at an external definition and say yes to that part and no to that part, but to say, what if I just started from scratch? Right. And what would that look like? And that blank slate, I think, is a little scary. Right. But also super liberating, because I get to not say yes or no to what other people are offering me, but maybe I create something new that doesn't even exist. That's not even a part of that. And think about that as manly or masculine for me, important to me as a man.
And how does that process work? Like, can you walk through that, like a blank slate type process? I mean, I'm 51, just turned 51 in December. And I was an old soul. I have a weird family situation where I kind of raised myself from 7 or 8, became an adult, quote unquote, very early. Yeah. And so I feel really comfortable in my own skin. Like And I'm really good at what you described, which is I have the innate ability to put on a mask, not in a bad way, not even in a negative way, but if I'm talking to a CEO of a $100 million company, I have a different conversation than the mechanic down the road that we happen to be having lunch with or whatever. Yep. Right. And so I'm trying to understand, like, how do you redefine that? Like, for, as someone that is pretty comfortable with who I am, and I'm continuing to learn, this podcast has been great for that, honestly, because I get to have conversations like this with people that I would ordinarily never have. Right. Like, this is not normal life for you to be able to talk to people all over the world and all that. But how does that process work in terms of like blank slate and redefining and all that?
Well, let me talk about it in terms of super micro, and then we can talk about some bigger ideas. So on a super micro level, how I do it day to day is I just notice like, oh, when I chose this sweater and this shirt, I thought, what's his podcast about? What are people going to like? Is this, you know, I had that, it was about 3 seconds, but I had that conversation and I just notice and go, oh, that's interesting that you are paying attention to how this will be perceived and not. And then I just go, is that how I want to think about that? I mean, sometimes it is. But one of the things that doing this research for almost 20 years now has taught me is that I'm not free from those expectations because I've done this research. I just notice it a lot more. I notice how I do it. I notice how I don't do it. I just notice it. And I probably notice maybe 30 times a day that I'm thinking about how will this be perceived? Is this man enough? When, you know, all these little things, from what I wear to what I say or how I say it and how I interact and even the conversations I have with myself. So for me, that's mass consciousness, right? Mm. And that's what you're describing. And when you have mass consciousness, you can choose a mask with intention, or what I would call conscious choice, right? And you gave great examples of that. When you don't have mass consciousness, you're just wearing a mask all the time, and you're no, there's no agency there, mm. right? But once you're aware, ooh, I do wear masks, and I shift them in different contexts, you can then notice, like, well, why did I make this assumption about my mechanic mm-hmm. and put on this mask? Maybe that wasn't fair to him. Maybe he is more open. Okay, let's try. And you can sort of do that. And so for me, I think mask consciousness, just awareness, just noticing. And, you know, I know you've talked a lot about mindfulness without judgment. Mm-hmm. Oh, hey, I'm wondering if this is blue enough.
Right.
Okay. Interesting. Well, that's a thing that you do, Keith. Okay. That doesn't really matter. That doesn't align with my values. So I'm not going to tend to that. I'm not going to dance with that. But then there might be other things, like I just interacted with my daughter's friends in this way. And no, that is how I want to interact. That is in line with my values. That is in line with who I want to be. So just noticing on a macro level, the process I talk about is from the research is it's called becoming. Mm-hmm. And this is really informed from the research, but also informed from coaching and some other psychology and other theories. And I'll define the process as becoming sort of like a math equation. Becoming equals a function of identity and integrity. And I would have thought we would figure out identity first and then move to integrity. So who am I? Which mm-hmm. is some of what we've been talking about. Who am I as a man? Okay, I got that figured out now. Now I need to do that consistently. And what the research taught me is it's not unidirectional. It's a conversation. So I think about this sort of the infinity symbol mm-hmm. on its side, sort of figure eight on its side, identity and integrity in conversations. Because the participants would say, I see myself as a very honest person. And I lied 3 times this week. So do I need to do better at integrity and stop lying? Or maybe I need to think of myself. Maybe I'm not as honest as I think I am. Do I need to change my identity? And those were talking to each other constantly, right? I've gotten a lot of feedback. I'm not a very good listener. And so I just think I'm just not a very good listener. But lately people are saying, wow, I really feel seen and heard by you. Maybe I need to change my self-identity as maybe I am a good listener now, right? And so those being in conversation, and accountability was really key to that. Both self-accountability, the noticing that I just described, or other people, like a conversation with your daughter might be like, oh, I guess I do this or that, mm-hmm. or I think about it in this way, or use the, I'll think about that, or friends or coworkers or things like that. But that conversation and identity, the process there is really self-awareness, which I break down into two parts. And then with integrity, it's self-management. So who am I? And then how am I doing? And then I think early on in that process, maybe folks who are in their 20s or 30s, that's a real like robust, active, conscious, like we're really working at it, mm-hmm. right? Who am I? Like really, who am I? I don't live at home. Now I have this job. Now I have my own family. Oh my goodness. Who let me bring kids home from the hospital?
I have no idea what the hell I'm doing.
Oh no, I had no clue. And then there's I've always thought I'm this person, but I guess I'm not really doing that. And falling short. And then I think the more you do it, it becomes more integrated. And we're still doing it because, as you said, you're still trying to figure out who you are, right? Mm-hmm. You're more certain about it, but you're not finished, right? Maybe a little fine tuning. Maybe 15 years ago, you were like more unclear and more trying to figure that out. And as I think we age, unless there's sort of a big crisis, which can be positive or negative, something really shocking to the system, our integrity gets refined and we become more comfortable. And we become comfortable being, you know, I'm just not a good listener and I've accepted that about me and I apologize a lot and I've worked at it or whatever the case may be. And it becomes a little bit we're still doing the same identity and integrity, but it's just a little bit less effortful, right? Where we just, and you know, as a coach, you know this, these are the people who just show up as who they are. They brag about their successes and they don't hide their weaknesses. And they're just like, this is who I am, you know, and that's fine. And if you don't like it, that's okay. But some people don't, that's fine. And I think, you know, some coaching things like really being able to handle your inner critic really help with that. Knowing your values, knowing your purpose in life can really help clarify that. But that's all about the self-awareness. And I break self-awareness into self-discovery and self-creation, and we can talk more about that. But
yeah, I'm curious on, because my wife has said this to me and my children, because mm-hmm. I'm continually mm-hmm. growing, and honestly over the last couple of years I feel like I've grown a lot. But it's like I used to be that guy, be like, you know, this is just me, this is my thought process, this is how I think, and I'm not going to change that. And this is just who I am. Well, my wife was like, yeah, but you're being an asshole. It's not okay just to keep being that, right? Like, you, this is because you're not the man that I know you can be. And what with our relationship, what's interesting is that she's often said, and I totally agree with her, is that she gets the best parts of me. I will be more kind, more empathetic, more caring, more giving. All of those best traits that I have, she gets, and then less so to other people.
And I think that's great. I hear a lot of people where it's the opposite, right? I get up, I work out, I go to work, I give my best self, and then I come home at 6 o'clock and I'm toast. And my partner, my kids get the exasperated, impatient, frustrated version of me. So good for you. That's great. But I also think that's what intimacy is, right? Where I remember a participant saying, you know, like, I live with my girlfriend, my sister, and my mom. Like, I can't pretend with them. It would be ridiculous, right? Or someone else said, you know, my wife's the strongest person I've ever known. So I'm not going to try and like outman her and be stronger than her. Like, I'll lose. Or, you know, at home is where I can take my mask off and share my fears or share what I'm really excited about. Sometimes our enthusiasm can feel really vulnerable.
Yeah.
But as you pointed out too, that's accountability. And so in the closer the relationship, I think the more seriously we take that accountability. If someone else calls you an asshole, you just go, well, you're an asshole, and you move on with your life. Right? Someone who you love and care about and you're invested in says, this isn't working. You go, oh, well, I'll pay attention to that. Help me understand. And I think that process of growth, I remember being 24, getting a master's degree in college student development, and my grandfather driving me to the airport. And he's like, what is it that you're getting a master's degree in? I said, well, I'm helping college students learn how to figure out who they are. And I was like, right, that's good. That's impressive. Like, grandpa, you're going to be impressed. And he was 74 at the time. And he was driving me to the airport. And he said, that's interesting. I think I'm still trying to figure out who I am.
Mm-hmm.
And I just had this moment of like, oh, shit. I'm going to be doing this for the rest of my life. Because I kind of had this, like, you finished that in college. And I like that because I had just finished college. So I wanted to be done, right? I wanted to be finished and self-actualized. A mentor of mine who's incredibly accomplished, he has this super impressive bio. And if you were to have him on, you'd read it and it'd be these amazing things. And the last line is, and he is wildly unfinished. Like something he's proud of.
Yeah.
This is how I'm wildly unfinished. And I'm working on that project and I'm interested and it's exciting and I can't wait to figure out who I am. But I think that learning and growing and realizing we're going to be different, both in terms of who we see ourselves as and how we show up in the world. I remember being in that car being like, oh no, that sounds like a lot of work. That sounds scary. That sounds unnerving. And then also now I find it like super exciting. Like, I'm a really different person than I was 4 years ago. And that means I'll be a different person just as much in 4 years.
Yeah. And it's really strange. It's really strange how even those small incremental changes happened. You know, clearly you're a way different person from that 24-year-old college kid, right?
Yep.
So,
yeah. And the world shapes us and our conversations shape us and where we live shape us and who we're surrounded with shapes us. The podcasts we listen to shape us, mm-hmm. right? You know, I know lots of people, all they listen to is true crime and it shapes them. And I listen to nerdy shit like this and it shapes me in a different way. And I'm not judging that as good or bad, but like, you know, if all you listen to are sports podcasts and, you know, then that shapes you. Mm-hmm. And so I love this notion about how we all know we should pay really good attention to what we consume in terms of food and nutrition, but what do we pay attention to our attention? What are we paying attention to? And what is drawing our focus? Because that really does shape us. Mm-hmm. And again, being conscious about that. And I love cheesy TV shows, but I do that as a choice, not I give up and I don't want to think about it. So this is just what I'm going to fill my life with. Like, no, this is fun time. This is entertainment. This is when I learn. And I learning isn't miserable. I love it. It's so fun for me. But yeah, what shapes us?
Yeah, that's the argument, right? That people are, I hope, are becoming more and more aware of. I saw a statistic, something like people under the age of 25 get 52% of their fact, quote unquote, I'm going to put this in quote, factual information from TikTok. And you know, the argument now, there's a lot of talk about what's going on in Gaza and Palestine and Israel and Hamas and all of that stuff. And they were actually showing some fairly decent data that the information being readily available is actually pro one side or pro the other side.
Yep.
And, you know, we have this intrinsic bias, right? And so the algorithm then feeds that bias. It's really freaking scary. Honestly.
It is. And it promotes the most outrageous take on anything, right?
Yeah.
Whether The Bear is a good show or not, the most outrageous take gets promulgated because people who agree like it and people who disagree hate it and then share it as isn't this trash, isn't this garbage? And, you know, and then that happens with Gaza, that happens with politics, that happens with masculinity, that happens with whether mindfulness is a good thing or not, right? So many different things. And I think being good consumers of that information is even going to get harder as AI, people are turning to AI, and I find it fascinating. I find it really helpful, but I don't trust it. I ask it questions and I go, oh, that's interesting. That's your answer. I don't necessarily believe that this is accurate. Cause there's so much of it that isn't true. And so how do we navigate through that? And, I find myself now seeing, you know, pictures of two people together on the Emmys red carpet. And I go, I don't know if that was real. Do they know were they even there? Or cause I can go on AI and say, put Kevin and Keith together on the Emmys red carpet. We can get an image that. So how do we do that? And I think just being, you know, I think mindfulness is incredibly important. Like, ooh, I'm drawn to TikTok and I'm drawn to things that validate my opinions. I'm also drawn to things that completely reject my opinions because I want that. How can you say that? And then I want someone to call them out and be outraged, and they're never outraged enough. And so I keep paying attention to that, which is both my attention, but that also feeds the algorithm and promotes this thing that I completely disagree with. How do we pay attention to what we're paying attention to? I think is a really important life skill.
And being kind of self-aware that it really is, like, not conspiratorial, but honestly, it's like I become more distrusting of the information that's been given to me over time. I actually proved this point to my wife because I was on TikTok or Instagram or one of those things, and we're, you know, flipping through my feed, and all of a sudden there's some, you know, young woman that's not dressed as, you know, with as many clothing as she should have. And she's like, why are you following that person? I'm like, I'm not. This was just fed to me. And so we went through the exercise. I actually created a brand new profile, a brand new account.
Yeah.
Said I was a man of this age, lived in this, and had these interests. And literally, before I did anything, it was filled with those kind of images.
Yeah. Yeah.
And so you have to be really cautious about, you know, that kind of stuff.
Yeah. Yeah, absolutely. And pay attention to it and be a savvy consumer. But then also, not just what do you want to avoid, but what do you want to engage in?
Mm-hmm.
You know, what feeds sort of the man that you want to be? What is affirming of that? My Instagram for a long time, I didn't follow anyone, not my mom, not my sister. It was just mindfulness and travel blogs mm-hmm. and art museums. It was this blissful little space of paintings and Bali and Jon Kabat-Zinn. And, that's shifted as I've started opening up, and particularly with the book coming out and marketing and things like that and sharing that. But it's remarkable how it's shifted and what comes in there. But what do we want to pay attention to? What mm-hmm. podcasts do we want to listen to? What books do we want to read? What conversations do we want to have? What people do we want to have over for dinner on Sunday? And if we're going to have these people over, what's the conversations we want to have or don't want to have? I'm hearing for a lot of people, they sort of fall into talking about politics, talking about polarization, talking about these things. And even when they're having conversations with people they completely agree with, it's not fulfilling.
Mm-mm.
And then they're not talking about their great conversation with their 26-year-old daughter about changing notions of masculinity in the Barbie movie, which sounds super interesting, right?
Yeah.
Even if you didn't like the movie.
I actually did while she was here. I actually did an episode. So we we didn't talk a lot about masculinity, but we, you know, so if you're listening to this podcast, hopefully you've listened to that one ahead of time. If you haven't, go back and listen to it. But I think
that's really great to talk about, you know, cross generations, cross different experiences, and learn from each other. There's a lot we can gain from wisdom and experience. And I also really value fresh, new, innovative, creative perspectives as well.
Yeah. How is all of that shaping, you know, what's going on with our understanding of masculinity now, especially, you know, and like you said, you've gone through kind of this multi-generational study. You know, I've got a poster behind me that says, you know, masculinity is not toxic. Some men just suck. And that's a very divisive way to say that the negative aspects of masculinity are typically more individualized than masculinity, you know, what masculinity should be.
Yeah.
How do we know what masculinity really quote unquote is? And I mean, especially in context of authentic masculinity, like you're talking about.
Well, I think about, you know, the way I think about toxic masculinity is no one who talks about toxic masculinity thinks men are toxic. They think the message is that you need to drink beer and be manly and have lots of sex and get drunk and always be successful and nutty, never study and have great pecs and flat abs. You know, that expectation is toxic, and it's toxic for men
mm-hmm.
and it's toxic for everybody, right? It's the roots of sexism. It's the roots of men not being good listeners. It's the roots of, you know, as you saw that Instagram feed that sort of you created, what funnels that. But if we stop thinking about men as toxic, but thinking about these expectations that we're putting on men, I think what men usually go is like, oh, well, I don't want to do what Budweiser wants me to do. I don't want to do what my Instagram feed or TikTok, like I want to decide. Mm-hmm. And so then it's about my agency. And I think what I see right now is sort of the national conversation that I see is people are really paying attention to how men are hurting. And I think for a long time, we've talked about how men are hurting others,
mm-hmm.
right? Through 99% of mass shootings are done by men as one example. Sexism is another example. Sexual violence is another example. Men in boardrooms not listening to women or talking over and interrupting is another example. But sort of we've talked about that. And now we're paying attention to how men are hurting, how men are being hurt too. And I think that both and is so critically important. Dying younger, being harmed by violence, mental health issues, heart disease, stress. I think the both and of that is really, really important. And so how do we help men figure out what's true for them, help them discover that, and have that not be the same answer for you and I? And I think the larger conversation right now is sort of saying, well, men are doing these things and that's a problem. And these things are happening to men and that's a problem. And the left doesn't have good answers because of this, and the right doesn't have good answers because of this, and oh no, what are we going to do? And I think because most of those people live in New York or Washington, D.C.
Yeah.
And they're surrounded by the solution to our problems is left or right, D or R. And I'd say, don't look to the left. Don't look to the right. Look within.
Mm-hmm.
So if you're listening to this conversation and thinking, well, who's going to tell me the man I should be? I would say, stop looking elsewhere. Look within. Like, what's the man you really want to be? And that to me is about that self-awareness. And I break self-awareness into self-discovery and self-creation. So self-discovery is, think about your life on a timeline of, let's say you're going to live to 100, maybe more, maybe less. And then where are you on that timeline? I'm at 47. So self-discovery is 0 to 47, everything that has happened in my life until now, right? Parents got divorced when I was 9. Played high school basketball poorly, got bullied, went to college, had some transformative experiences. So everything that has happened, life experiences, move, that has shaped me and made me who I currently am. And the more aware I am about all those experiences and all those conversations and falling in love and falling out of love and breaking your arm when you were 10 and all of that stuff has shaped me. And when you're really clear about that, then you have a really good foundation. But that's half the story. The other half is self-creation, which is, who do I want to be? What are the choices I want to make? Are we going to have a third kid? Are we going to move to a bigger house? What am I going to have for dinner?
Right.
Like, all of these things, as you said, the little things add up. There's big decisions, but the little things add up. And if we don't figure out what got us here, then we kind of build a house on not a great foundation. Mm-hmm. If we understand the foundation, but don't have agency for creating the life we want to have, then we're just victims to our circumstances. And so we need that foundation of understanding about what got us here. And then also, what is the things you're going to make your choices? And so when I'm coaching men, we do a lot of discovery about what's shaped you, right? And it's amazing how you can remember things that you haven't thought of in 20 years, mm-hmm. right? Like, oh my gosh, that relationship, that moment. I often think about that. I went to Hamline University, which is here in St. Paul, Minnesota, for college. It completely has shaped my entire life since. And the reasons I went there is they sent me mail early. I liked the colors, and they had pizza had pizza. And there's no part of that decision was what I would recommend to anyone about how you should choose a college, but it shaped so many things in my life. My best friends to this day are people who I met there. My career would absolutely be different if I had gone to another very similar school in a very similar place, but those things shape us. And then, what do you want to guide the decisions and choices you make? Do you want to, you know, what's convenient or what's easy or what everybody else is doing? Or do you want to be clear about, these are my values, this is my purpose, this is who I want to be? And as you said, that'll change and evolve. That might shift as you go, but How do you be on that journey? And then that's just the identity part. Then the other part is, how am I doing? Right? Like, I say I want to not be on Twitter, but I'm on Twitter a lot. Mm. Okay. So I need to work on that, right? Is that, you know, I say I want to be an attentive dad, and I find myself excited when the kids go to bed. Okay. I want to do better at that, right? And really letting those moments guide us and shape us. And some of that is about masculinity. That's just, some of that's about being a dad. That's some of that's just about being a good human. So some of it isn't even connected to manhood or masculinity, but, you know, for some folks, what's the Christian that you want to be?
Mm-hmm.
What's the husband that you want to be? What kind of leader do you want to be in your company? What kind of neighbor do you want to be? Are you going to run for school board? Is that something that aligns with your values or not? And you want to make contributions in a different way.
I really like that kind of those two sides of that coin and yeah. kind of through that process. First of all, I think the creating part is that's dynamic, right? That could be yeah. a daily thing, a yearly thing, a 5-year, 10-year, whatever. I often use this, you know, I like these stark contrast kind of mm-hmm. statements. But, you know, there's a Christian song that talks about how, you know, dear younger me, it's not your fault. And mm-hmm. I hate that line mm-hmm. in that song, because I use this phrase that, hey, wherever you happen to be in your life, there's a pretty good chance that it is your fault, because it's mm-hmm. it's the decision making that you've made. But I couple yeah. that with the good news: if it's your fault, you can actually change the yeah. outcome moving forward.
Right.
You can't change what you did, but you can change how you move yeah. forward.
I love Jerry Colonna, who's a great coach, talks about his most famous question is, how are you complicit in the conditions you say you don't want? Mm-hmm. And I love that word complicit, because it's not how are you responsible, because that's sort of 100% on you.
Right.
But like,
right.
what role have you played? And some of those, sometimes I'm really complicit. And sometimes it's not really me, but I've allowed it. I've not stood up for myself or not challenged it. And then I love that you say you don't want, because there's a lot of times I say I don't want something, but it actually, like, I say I don't want to be mad at my kids, but it kind of feels good to be right.
Yeah.
Oh. Okay, I'm kind of enjoying being right. Oh. So maybe I'm perpetuating this conflict because I like being right. Mm-hmm. Okay, I got to let that go. I love that. And if we can think back, I love Brené Brown talks about how we're all doing the best that we can, mm-hmm. which I just find to be true. And sometimes our best isn't very good.
I used to joke with my kids, and I would say, you know, sometimes your best simply isn't good enough.
Yeah.
Yes. And that's okay. What that yes. means is whatever activity you're trying to be best at, if your yeah. best is not going to give you what you need in that particular situation, maybe there's a different situation to put yourself in, right?
Or some self-compassion. Like if you yep. just find out your mom has breast cancer, you might not be paying great attention to this podcast conversation.
Right. Yep.
And that's okay. And to understand that, or maybe you've got a cold, or maybe you're well rested and you're on top of your game and you're vibing and you did 20 minutes of meditation and you're totally dialed in and your best is really great. Mm-hmm. Great. Good. That's awesome. And I find that great for my own grace, but then with others who irritate me, just realizing they're doing their best. Mm-hmm. Like no one wants to suck.
Yeah.
No one's like pumped about that. But some people are just having a really rough time, maybe in their life, maybe today, maybe in this moment. Maybe they're getting text messages about some crisis or something like that, or maybe they're worried or distracted. Maybe they're having financial trouble, and so they're not totally dialed in and paying attention. But I just love that notion. Everyone's doing the best that they can. That doesn't mean everyone's doing great,
yeah, right.
But it might be the best they can today. And that really just allows me to have empathy and compassion without giving up on people. Mm-hmm. Like if I assume that of you and we're not having a great moment, I might say, well, I don't know what's going on, but I think Kevin's doing the best he can. I'm still going to tell him this thing didn't land well with me.
Right.
Right. And you might not take that very well, or you might be really appreciative, but I'm just going to assume that you're doing the best you can today. And maybe we'll do it another time or right, whatever that might be. But I spent the last two chapters of the book are engaging men and creating social change. So the last one is about how do we change this culture. We talked a little bit about outrage and social media. How do we create cultural change so that the external expectations are better and better, or people can get past them and get to that liberation and authentic masculinity sooner? But the chapter right before that is about engaging men. And I really wrote that for my daughter's kindergarten teacher. I wrote that for coaches. I wrote that for social workers, because a lot of people who are in helping, who are helping men, are women. Mm-hmm. Elementary school teachers, social workers, therapists are overwhelmingly women, and men who are in those roles don't often have good examples of that.
Yeah.
And they had a great kindergarten teacher. She doesn't know I wrote it for her, but she was awesome. She's incredible. And every year she gets 15 or so boys who've been shaped by 5 years in this world, who will go on to contribute to this world for another 95-ish years. And I believe she loves them in her own very appropriate way. And what would be helpful for her to understand, connect, and help guide them through 9 months of that process? Mm-hmm. And she has incredible training. about how to do that with reading and creativity and math and colors. What would be helpful for her to navigate those boys through being a boy, or to help a psychologist who was trained by mostly women professors, who had a cohort of women who did their a lot of that, and then, you know, has a caseload of men who are really struggling. And then one psychologist said to me, I thought everything went men's way and these guys are really struggling and I don't know how to help them, because I just assumed like everything would go their way. And
they're guys, they get every, you know, everything.
They have all this privilege, which they do, and everything goes their way, but they're struggling because they feel like they need to be the only provider and they have to protect their family from everything. And they feel helpless in these ways. And they're worried about their cholesterol levels and, you know, to help them connect with empathy. That's the connect with empathy and hold accountable effectively. And we have terrible models for accountability. I mean, accountability is really just passed off as blame, shame, and dehumanization. Mm-hmm. And that's not accountability. That's what Brené Brown would say. It's a discharging of your own hurt, pain, and anguish.
So right? What is accountability supposed to look like then?
Well, a couple of distinctions. So, blame and accountability. Blame is discharging of your own pain. That's when I take out my ish on you. Like, I can't believe you use this word and you swore and you're ridiculous. You're disrespectful. That's just blame. Accountability is, it really hurt my feelings when, so accountability is vulnerable.
Mm-hmm.
It hurt my feelings, or I felt really disappointed. I also love Brené's distinguishing between guilt and shame. So guilt is, I've done or said something I regret. Shame is, I'm a bad person.
Mm-hmm.
So guilt is, I made a mistake. Shame is, I'm a mistake.
Mm-hmm.
That just lands really differently. And so if we can focus our accountability not on the person, but on what they did or said, we have a much better chance of them learning, being open. If you say, Keith, I can't believe you said that thing in a meeting, I go, oh, well, let me understand. I'd love to know more. And the more guilt I feel about that, ooh, I don't want to say that again, the less likely I am to do it again. But if you say, what is wrong with you? It's not about what I said in the meeting. You're saying, I'm broken. I'm wrong. Mm-hmm. I'm bad. I'm immoral. And I'm not open to your feedback because I want to defend that I'm a good person. So mm-hmm. I get defensive. I'm not open. I'm not listening. I'm walling it off. So in the book, I talk about how do we accept accountability, right? So when you say, hey, can I talk about that meeting? How do I go, okay, I'm not a bad person, but maybe Kevin has something I can learn from here, right?
Mm-hmm.
So how do we accept accountability? But then how do we offer it, right? So let's say, I don't say, what's wrong with you? Oh, you're so gross. And instead I say, hey, you know, in that meeting, I heard you talk over Maxine 3 different times. How can I help you not do that in future meetings? Well, then you go, oh, okay. Well, I hadn't even noticed. I really like Maxine. Okay. Maybe you give me a little nudge, or I don't know what we come up with, but when we, I think accountability goes wrong when we don't allow for the possibility that the other person could grow, change, or be different.
Mm-hmm.
And then we're just sorting, which is great at Hogwarts, putting you into a different house, but it doesn't lead to growth, learning, and change. And so how do we do accountability in a way that leads to growth, learning, and change for you, for me, for the world, for my daughter's middle school? And if we just say, ugh, this place sucks, this guy sucks, you suck, I suck, then that just leads to like regression and not openness. And so how do we say, I mess up all the time. And some ways I'm aware of it and I'm working on it. And if you see ways that I'm messing up that I'm not aware of, I would really appreciate that. Because mm-hmm. then I can, you know, I had no idea I interrupted Maxine. I had no clue. I'm so, oh, help me, right? And so I think that that possibility for growth, learning, and change is so critical. There's a great, Valerie Kaur, who's a Sikh activist and did a lot of work after 9/11, has a new book called Revolutionary Love. And she said, I spent the first 20 years organizing around hate. I'm going to spend the next 20 organizing around love. And that's a pretty radical shift.
Yeah, that is a big shift for sure. No. One of the challenges I think that we have, at least in my own situation, is I've been married to my wife for 28 years. Like I said, it's friggin' amazing.
Getting better all the time is what I hear.
It is. It is. Yep. And however, you know, I'm continuing to grow, and I feel like that my growth is kind of accelerating the last couple of years, especially. This podcast has actually made me a better listener, made me more open, not necessarily changing who I am, my ethics and morals, and, you know, the essential understanding of the world. But we had a discussion, you know, we often have these discussions that would be like, well, you always do these things. You know, it's like, this is because it became so ingrained in my bad behavior, whether I'm a poor listener or I talk over her, which just tends to be one of my bad habits. Yep. I'm impatient, so that makes me a bad listener. Mm-hmm. But I'm working, and
I like to solve the problem and fix it.
Oh, can you do that too? Me too. Yeah. Me too.
Yep.
But that's we had the discussion the other day. I'm like, hey, you got to give me some credit for the growth that I'm having now. Yep. And because it's easy to say this is who you are. And so like that becomes a challenge to deal with when you're dealing with someone that you've been married to or been with together, or, you know, children, whatever.
I think it's critical, an important person. I won't say who to protect him, but, was divorced and remarried. And I said, you know, what'd you learn? And he said, my first marriage, we grew apart. Mm-hmm. My second marriage, we're growing together. And I think about that all the time as someone who loves to learn and loves to grow and loves to change. How do I make sure we're not doing that on opposite trajectories, but we're doing that together in unison? And I think I think we don't have enough conversations about how we're changing.
Mm-hmm.
Right. And I think when one person is growing, both people can resent it. A person who's really growing and changing could resent, like, well, keep up with me. Like, be on this journey with me. Like, why aren't you also, you know, listening to cool podcasts like this and reading these books and doing this and doing a better morning routine? But the person who's not growing is like, hey, we had a deal. You're not the same person.
Mm-hmm.
And I resent that you're changing. And so I think being more open in our relationships about, here's how I'm growing. I mean, this is the beauty of being a coach, right? You get backstage pass to how people are changing constantly.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I talk with my coaching clients about every 2 weeks and they're different humans from 2 weeks to 2 weeks. Right. And, but we assume the people around us are the same people they've always been, right? My friend I've known for 20 years, I pretty much interact with him the same way I knew him 5 years ago.
Right.
But he's a completely different person. I'm just not up to speed on all of the details of that. Some of that's visible, right? A change in relationship, a change in job, you move to a new location, you start a meditation practice, you get fit, you gain weight, whatever. Some of that we can see, but a lot of that change is just like, I no longer think of the world in this way.
Mm-hmm.
And how would anyone know that? And how do we have conversations about one of my favorite questions? Well, my favorite question is, Kevin, who are you becoming?
Mm-hmm.
Because it's not who are you, which is static, right? But who are you becoming, or who are you on the cusp of becoming? Well, I think I might be on the cusp of becoming someone who meditates, or I think I might be becoming Buddhist, or I think I might be becoming someone who plays the guitar, or I might be becoming really good at editing videos, or whatever the case might be. But having those conversations, and I think, you know, the old adage is communication is key to any relationship, and I think that's totally true. But how do we have the conversations about, you know, how are you different from who I married 28 years ago? How are you different from before we had kids?
Mm-hmm.
How are you different from before you left that job and started this new one? How are you different since you committed to this exercise routine? How is it shaping you. And well, my self-discipline, I used to fear it. Now I love it. Now I want more things that I can try and be disciplined, because it's just, it's fun for me to wrestle and struggle and do things. So I think sharing the journey, we don't have to grow and learn in the same ways, but be on the similar paths. And sometimes other people are growing in ways that we don't give them credit for.
Mm-hmm.
Like, wow, I had no idea you've been working really hard at that for the past 3 months. Like, I just didn't know. But that's a great, it's kind of a fun path to intimacy, right?
Yeah, it's, I mean, and honestly, it's one of the best things about having the kind of relationship, because we grew up together. We got married at 21 and 22, mm-hmm. which people would be like, man, that's super young, especially now.
Right.
But like, we totally grew up together, and we've grown up together throughout every stage.
Right. Yeah.
And it's crazy, whether it's our intimate relationship, our communication, or our dating now with each other and all of these things, like it changes all the time. I don't think people give credit to the ability to have that change in a relationship that lasts for 40, 50, 60 years.
Yeah.
Or the joy that can come with that. And I'm not shaming anybody that has been through a divorce and it didn't work out or whatever.
Sure.
But yeah, it's freaking awesome. I mean, we've done counseling 5 or 6 times. We call it tune-ups, you know, as we go through different phases, and we've had like some serious life changing epiphanies through some of those. But that growth together is really what brings that closeness together.
And isn't it fun?
Oh yeah.
Right. And I think just acknowledging that people in relationships change. I remember having our first kid and changing a diaper and being like, well, this is my life now.
Yeah.
Okay. And then 4 years later, I was changing my last diaper and I was sad. I was like, we're done with this.
Mm-hmm.
I thought this was my life. And it was such a great reminder of the impermanence of parenthood. Mm-hmm. Right now I'm at the shuttling them to and from sports practices and games stage of parenthood.
Yeah.
I was at the stage where you had to watch them every minute. And soon I'll be at the stage where they're driving themselves around, and I won't like that better. Then they'll be to college, and then they have their own life. Right. And that impermanence, I think, is more visible, to parents of children, but our relationships with our partners have the same impermanence.
Mm-hmm.
Our relationship with our parents has the same impermanence. My dad is a very different person than he was 5 years ago. My grandfather was trying to figure out who he was at 74. Our close friendships. And I think when we just recognize that everyone is doing the best that they can and a work in progress, people become more interesting. You know, I love the Buddhist notion of beginner's mind. Let's have this conversation as though we've never had it before.
Mm-hmm.
How do you talk to a partner of 28 years as though you don't know what she thinks about X,
mm-hmm.
or you don't know what she's going to say? Like, my partner comes home and I say, how was your day? And I pretty much know what she's going to say. And then I'm not really listening.
Yeah, right.
But how could I ask that question and really bring this beginner's mind? Like, what if I pretended I had no clue what's going to come out of her mouth? I would really dial in. I would really pay. What if I had no idea what her job was, or how her coworkers are irritating her, or how she responds, or what she thinks about? Oh, that's intimacy. Listening to someone as though you have no idea is genuine curiosity. And boy, when you can do that, it's transformative.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's a lot of fun. And our kids both left home at 17. They were homeschooled. Mm-hmm. So they've been gone for 5 or 6 years. And, you know, I hear people lament about their kids going off and all that. I mean, empty nesting is awesome. I'll just tell you right now. I mean, you know, we love our kids. We love it when they come home, but we also love this stage of our, you know, kind of freedom and, you know, all of that too.
Well, I think that's because you've embraced this impermanence idea. Like, well, this is what we're doing. This is our parenting thing now. And I'm always trying to do this stage with everything I got. So when it's done, I'm ready to let it go and not missing it. I used to work in colleges and universities, and we would have parents who would come for orientation, and we would have smaller groups who have parents who would come to drop their kids off for sports before everybody else did. So it was a smaller group that have some conversations. And every time there would be, say, 25 parents. And over here would be this couple And they'd be like, this is our last one. Can you help us? What are we going to do? We're going to be alone. And over here was a couple. This is our last one.
Yeah.
We can't wait. We're so excited. We're going to do new things. We're going to plant a garden. We're going to travel. And they were having the same experience, but their perspective on it was really different.
Yeah.
And that was so stunning to me because I saw it so often. And both of their experiences are real, but it's a great example of it's not what you experience, but how you respond, how you react, how you make meaning of it, how you connect with it can really shape your experience. They were seeing this as a tremendous loss and an end. And they were seeing this as, wow, curiosity, excitement, what's this going to look like? Now we get to have a different relationship with our kids, which I think is really great.
Yeah. And a lot of times that fear is because you may or may not have done all the work you needed to do to make sure that the person you're standing next to, that part of the relationship is solid enough that you know.
We got to hang out with each other now?
Yeah. I don't even know
this person. I kind of like talking about the kids all the time.
I've called this person mom for the last 20 years, even though she's my wife, you know.
Yeah.
Whatever. So, yeah, for sure.
But I think just opening ourselves up to, and this is why I love this notion of becoming, we talked about it in terms of masculinity, but like constantly asking myself, who am I? What am I doing? How's that align? How does that not as a failure, but noticing that misalignment, that incongruence, that dissonance as that's where learning is. That's where my growth is. Ooh, where is it showing up? Where do I say this or see myself as this? And I'm not quite doing that. All right. Well, that's where I can grow. That's where I can learn. That's where I can shift. Yeah, it's really exciting. And I think as a parent, I'm trying to do the best I can at this stage, and I'm trying to savor it as best I can so that when the next one comes, I'm like, okay, I really changed the shit out of those diapers. Like I did it. I gave it all I had. I'm good. I'm ready to now have a kid who can tell me that they're hungry and that they love me. That's exciting. Right. And now I've got a kid who can tell me about difficulties with friends. Now I've got kids who want to talk about boxing out and all of these other things, which is also super fun, but a different stage in the process.
Yeah.
They don't snuggle me like they used to, but ask for basketball tips and that's different.
Yeah. Those relationships change in a really cool way. You know, I love the adult friendship type relationship that I have with my girls now. And it's totally different. I get smarter every year, surprisingly,
but
so, as they learn more, so do I. So, evidently my perspective wasn't as bad as what they thought when they were 14.
I think back at, you know, things the lack of grace I gave my parents when I was 15. I'm just like, sorry.
Yeah.
My bad.
our girls both would be like, I'm really sorry for how I acted when I was 14 and 15. And you know, that tends to be the challenging thing. But I
think that's important because they probably said or did horrible things to you. And to come back now, 15 or 10 years later and say, I'm sorry about that.
Yeah.
Even if you don't even remember, right? Still is a form of repair, right? There's a conflict and how do we bring that sense of repair to our relationships? I was just thinking about this with a friend who I just treated really poorly in a particular situation, just saying, you know, hey, I was not in a good place then. I'm really sorry. I wasn't very understanding or I was judgmental of you. I see it differently now, right? And that repair, I think, is great. In the moment, it's great. 2 weeks later, it's great. 10 years later, just a little acknowledgement makes a big difference.
Yeah, it's never too late to kind of get those repaired. Well, I want to be cognizant of your time, respectful of your time. Can you give us, and this will be a loaded question, kind of if I'm a guy kind of wrestling with some of this stuff, the idea of authentic masculinity, can you kind of give me one easy strategy to kind of begin this journey? On a lot of these podcasts, I always like to get my guests to kind of say, okay, well, and I use the phrase, you know, start from where you're at. This is this is where you are. This is where you're starting. Kind of that jumping off point for taking this journey.
Yeah. I started this research thinking we needed to teach men a different way of being a man. And the research taught me we don't. We need to give them permission to stop being who they feel they have to be and permission to be who they really are.
Mm-hmm.
So if someone's listening and that's their question, what I would say is I give you permission to stop being who you feel you're supposed to be. And I give you permission to figure out and be who you really are. And enjoy that for the rest of your life. Don't make it icky homework. Make it a delight. And it's going to change and it's going to shift. And that's a delightful thing. And, you know, as coaches, we often say, you know, don't should on yourself. And shoulds are always external expectations. Mm-hmm. And sometimes we should things that are really ours, right? Like, oh, I should go to my kid's basketball game. I want to.
Yeah.
I really do. But if I think about it as I should, oh, it's scheduled. I've got to go. She wants me there. I don't go to those games for her.
Yeah.
I actually go because of me. So sometimes it's just a shift in perspective. And I think we can bring that to everything. So what are the external expectations you feel as a man, as a Christian, as a CEO, as a father, as a brother? What are the expectations? How do you let go of those external expectations and figure out how do you want to do this, right? How do you want to parent a three-year-old? How do you want to lead your next staff meeting? What's genuine and authentic for you? If you can figure that out and then do that more often, life gets magical.
That's awesome. And how do we find more about you and order the book? And
yeah. Find more about me, keithedwards.com. Super easy. The book you can find there. It's everywhere. Audible, Amazon, Bookshop, wherever you might want to get your books. The best way to stay connected with me is I have a newsletter called Sharing Fire that I send out every 2 weeks. It's 100% free. No pitches, no sales, no nonsense. I just share my latest thinking, two or three things that I'm learning, which are podcasts or things like this, things I'm doing, and then things that inspire me, which is usually music or a great TV show. I'm currently recommending Drops of God, which is a great series on Apple. Three different languages about wine and family and all sorts of things. Super intense and super fun. So KeithEdwards.com is the best place to find me. The book you can find there and anywhere. And if you want to connect with me in an ongoing way, Sharing Fire is a way to do that. You can find that so easily on my website. Just sign up there.
Awesome. I think I need to go sign up for that then. Yeah. For sure.
Yeah.
Thanks, Keith. I appreciate your time, man.
Yeah. Great to talk with you, Kevin.
Yep. Have a great day.
Yep.
If you're looking to really maximize your life and become the man you were made to be, head over to maxedoutman.com and get your journey started today.